that are membrane transport system. So we know with the substances like oxygen, glucose, hormones, etc. Mainly they need to be transported inside the cell. And the secretions of the cell should be transported outside the cell. So this transport is mainly by the different process. So first when we have the simple diffusion, so this is it doesn't require any energy because it just transmits, you know, from higher concentration to lower concentration. So example, here I have oxygen, carbon dioxide. So oxygen, you know, it goes inside the cell and carbon dioxide comes out of the cell, so without any energy. So that is from high concentration to low concentration, because we know oxygen is outside more when compared with inside, so it easily goes inside. And carbon dioxide is outside more when compared inside it is more in the cell, so it comes outside from high concentration to low concentration. So the rate of diffusion is directly proportional to the concentration gradient, because if that is high concentration to low concentration, then the diffusion also easily takes place. And the rate of diffusion is also directly proportional to the surface area of the membrane. So, you know, surface area of the membrane, if the area of the membrane is high, then the diffusion also will be high, and if the surface area is low, then the diffusion will be low. And also solubility, you know, the substances which are easily soluble can easily undergo diffusion process, and if they are less soluble, then less diffusion. So increased lipid soluble substances are having more diffusion, because we know our cell membrane is made up of lipid bilayer. So if the substances are lipid soluble, then they can easily pass by the cells. So there is high diffusion in lipid soluble substances, and the rate of diffusion is inversely proportional to the thickness of membrane, of course, because if the membrane is more thicker, then the rate of diffusion decreases, and if the membrane is thin, then the rate of diffusion increases. And even rate of diffusion is inversely proportional to the molecular weight, same like, because if the weight is more, then it is very hard to pass to the substances. If the weight is less, then they can easily pass. So by this we can say that simple diffusion is a downhill process that is no required no need of any energy, and this is also a passive transport. So we can say simple diffusion is a passive transport. And now let us see the facilitated diffusion. Even this is one of the passive transport. It doesn't need any energy, but the only difference between simple diffusion and facilitated diffusion is in the facilitated. In the name you can see it is facilitated by certain proteins, so that is the difference between simple diffusion and facilitated diffusion. So here examples you can take like insulin, glucose and charged substances, and also very large molecular weight substances. You know, these cannot be easily passed by our membrane, like insulin, glucose, charged substances like sodium, calcium. So they don't dissolve directly, so they are facilitated by some proteins or carriers which are present. So the sodium, calcium are more in the extracellular matter, but the potassium is more inside the cell due to the sodium potassium ATPase, we know. The sodium potassium ATPase put the 3 sodium outside and 2 potassium inside. It sends 3 sodium outside and 2 potassium inside. So due to this pump, the potassium is more inside the cell, and the movement of sodium calcium through sodium calcium water tunnel channels is possible, and potassium leaky channel remain open all the time, because potassium channel is potassium have 2 types of channels. One is leaky channel and one is voltage gated channel. Voltage gated channel is not open all the time, but the leaky channel, this is always open. And the voltage gated sodium channels are always regulated. Likewise, even potassium gated channels, voltage gated channels are also regulated. And the resting membrane potential is inside the cell, actually it is -90 millivolts, that is where the sodium gates are closed. So this concept we need to understand. Whenever there is resting membrane potential, the sodium gates are closed, and these channels are voltage gated channels. So the voltage gated sodium channels are closed in resting membrane potential, and whenever there is at -60 mV, then the sodium gates are open. So this we need to remember. When there is resting membrane potential, actually inside the cell, you know, there is higher concentration of potassium and other substances. Potassium is inside in the cell more, and sodium, chlorine, all the substances are outside the cell. They are highly concentration. So inside the cell, whenever there is resting membrane potential, that is when the cell is in resting position, then the sodium gates are closed, and when the sodium gates are open, there is high influx of sodium, that is positive charge. So now this resting potential from minus, it may shift towards the positive side. and few sodium channels are opened by few substances and they are called as ligand operated channels. So actually we have ligand operated channels and also voltage gated channels. Voltage gated channels are like this, the name only can understand, voltage means negative, positive, so ion dependent, whereas this ligand gated channels are chemical dependent. So now we can say that facilitated diffusion is also passive transport. It is downhill, no need of energy. Now let us move on to sodium potassium ATPase mechanism. Once let us check out this sodium potassium mechanism addition. So you can see this is inside the cell and this is outside the cell. So actually what happens is, you can see the three sodium are out of the cell, actually first inside the cell, this three sodium from the cell are taken out by flipping. You can see here the process of flipping takes place. So to flip this we need some energy. So now the ATP is break down into ADP and phosphate. So by this energy the pump is shifted so that three sodiums will come outside and two potassium will come inside. So you can see this is an inside cell. So inside the cell the potassium concentration is very high and outside the cell the sodium concentration is very high because of this pump. So this is how the pump works. It brings 3 sodium outside the cell and 2 potassium inside the cell by utilizing ATP. So here only you can understand it is utilizing ATP. So it is a uphill process and it needs the energy, and ATP is converted into ADP and phosphate. It is of course an active transport. So the passive transport examples are simple diffusion, facilitated diffusion, but the sodium potassium ATPase pump is of course active transport. And when energy is used directly, it is called primary active transport. And if energy is used indirectly, it is called secondary active transport. We will also look at that and get a clear idea about this process. So you can see here the calcium is pumped into endoplasmic reticulum against the concentration gradient. And this concept also can easily understand. Actually, calcium pumped into against concept, because already endoplasmic reticulum have large amount of calcium, but inside the cell you know calcium is low, so it should be pumped against the concentration gradient. So now the ATP is broken down into ADP and phosphorus. So from the cytosol into the endoplasmic reticulum, this is known as calcium ATPases, because here now ATP is used to bring the calcium inside, so it is called as calcium ATPases. And here you can see here both sodium and potassium are moving against concentration gradient, because we know sodium is more outside the cell, but that sodium only we are getting out of the cell, and we know potassium is more inside the cell, but we are bringing the same potassium inside once it is against the concentration gradient. So here also ATP is utilized. So here the name is sodium potassium ATPase, and here we are pumping the calcium against the concentration gradient. So then by using ATP, so it is calcium ATPase. So next let us see the secondary active transport. As we said, if the energy is indirect, energy is used indirectly, then it is called secondary active transport. So let us see how it is used indirectly. So this is also against concentration gradient, but here the energy is utilized indirectly. Example, glucose in the GIT is taken up by the cell against the concentration gradient. So actually you know glucose already in the GIT it is very high, and whenever we eat food we know again glucose in the vessel, blood vessels is increased. So it is taken up against the concentration gradient by facilitated diffusion of sodium, by facilitated diffusion of sodium. So this is important. Actually sodium is taken inside by facilitated diffusion, and glucose is taken by the cell against concentration gradient. And by facilitated diffusion we take sodium. So this is actually a sodium glucose symport, or this is also called as co-transporter. Co-transporter means two substances are at a time coming inside. So here glucose is coming and sodium is coming inside the cell, but the glucose is coming against concentration gradient and the sodium is coming just by the facilitated diffusion by some facilitated protein. So here what happens is the sodium potassium ATPases are utilizing energy from the sodium. So this is thing to take up the glucose inside. We are not taking that energy directly from the glucose, but we are taking that energy from the facilitated diffusion part of sodium. So sodium potassium ATPase are utilizing the energy from the sodium and glucose co-transporter. So indirectly it is responsible for the glucose transport. So that is what it is. So the toxic substances like actually they done an experiment, like toxic substance obey it dysfunctions the sodium potassium ATPase. So now what happens is sodium goes up and sodium glucose can't come inside of the cell. So they want to check that whether this is true or not, that indirectly it is using energy. Yes, if we block this by a toxic substance obane at this site, this co-transporter is not working out and the glucose and sodium are still not able to come inside the cell. So this is what the secondary active transport. So primary active transport is we are utilizing the energy directly, but in the case of secondary active transport, we are utilizing the energy in a indirect way. So example, we can also take one more example, like these are the symports, right? And here we take sodium amino acid co-transporter. This is also one of the symport. Here also where sodium and amino acids are coming inside the cell by means of co-transport, that is both are coming at a time into the cell. And even here I think one substance is coming by facilitated diffusion, another against concentration gradient. By utilizing the energy of that facilitated diffusion part, it is coming. So it is also indirect transport, that is secondary active transport. So actually you can say one side it binds to the sodium and inside it binds to the proton. So this is one more mechanism. You can say inside it binds to the proton and one side to the sodium, and it undergoes flip, then the proton comes out and the sodium enters inside. So by flipping, the proton moves out and the sodium is coming inside the cell. So it is not the co-transport, it is known as counter-transport or antiports. So before you see symport, symport means both are coming at a time, but this is antiport or counter-transport because here the proton is getting out and the sodium is coming in, that is both not two are not coming inside or two are not going outside, there in opposite fashion. So now let us see the facilitated. Here you can see the facilitated and primary active transport, secondary active transport. These all are carrier mediated, means they need a carrier. Yes, in the facilitated we need protein, in the primary active transport we need energy, in the secondary active transport also we need a carrier. So these three are carrier mediated, and the facilitated and the primary active transport show the stereospecificity. So the facilitated diffusion and the primary active transport, they show stereospecificity. That is, for example, you can say glucose, it is divided into D-glucose, L-glucose. D-glucose is the dextroglucose, L-glucose is the liver glucose, and the D-glucose, they are specific only for the D but not for the L. And they also show saturation phenomena, that is whenever glucose is very high, that more carriers are also increased and the transport is maximum. But there is certain limit, that if the glucose is more higher than the carriers, means if you ate lot of food but the carriers are not sufficient to take that glucose inside, so that glucose comes out in the urine. So this case you can see in the diabetes mellitus, glucose in urine. Actually this case in diabetes mellitus, it is because of, like, there are more more insulin present in diabetes mellitus. There are, you know, these patients have low insulin, so that the receptors are not present for glucose to take them inside the cell. So here what happens in diabetes mellitus is that, so that the glucose increase in the blood and finally it comes into the urine. So the glucose in urine in the case of diabetes mellitus. So here the carriers are saturated and showing the saturation phenomena. And competition, so actually similar compound to glucose is the galactose. So the galactose competes with the glucose in the transport at the GIT for the same transporter and carrier protein, because there are no other transporters. So for the same transporter, this glucose and galactose are competing. So this is competition. Now let us see some vesicular transport. Actually, what is this vesicular transport? Substances are transported in the membranes by membrane bound vesicles. So this actually into the cell means endocytosis, and if you want to send this vesicles out the cell means exocytosis. So capture the extracellular material, it is endocytosis, and endocytosis is divided into three types, like pinocytosis, phagocytosis and receptor endocytosis. So pinocytosis means it's nothing but taking the fluid inside the cell, cell drinks the extracellular fluid. Phagocytosis means taking up the microorganisms or any harmful, so special actin proteins which reorganize to pull the vesicle inside. And we have receptor endocytosis. Here clathrin coated pits help in moving in and later convert into the clathrin vesicles. And you can see here example of receptor mediated endocytosis is liver cells which take up the LDL cholesterol, that is low density lipoprotein, by means of this clathrin coated pits and help in moving in and lateral convert into clathrin vesicles. And now let us see exocytosis. This is nothing but it is expressed when something is secreted in the cell so that it should get out from the cell. So example, you can see here the in pancreas the beta cells of insulin have calcium influx and forming vesicles move towards the cell membrane. So release out the insulin, because you know now insulin reaches the blood to the muscle, fat cells, etc. So now it starts producing receptors. So now insulin should get out, means it is undergoing the process of exocytosis. So hormones are released by exocytosis, and also neurotransmitters release acetylcholine by input of calcium. So they are calcium dependent. So you can see they are calcium dependent. Insulin also, when calcium is coming inside the cell, then only they are sticking to the cell membrane and getting out of the cell. So this is exocytosis process. So this exocytosis and endocytosis together are called as vesicular transportation, because the vesicles are formed in this both cases. So this is about a simple and complete overview of our transport mechanisms. Now we will also check out some of the important points from our textbook. So actually the water allowing channels are mainly the channel proteins. So remember that those are the channel proteins which allow the water. And we have one more important definition, that is about osmolality. Let us understand the difference between osmolality, lity and riti. So actually osmolality is a solution which is having 1 osmole of solute dissolved in each kilogram of water, and it is said to have a osmolality of 1 osmole per kg. So 1 osmole is 1 gram molecular weight of osmolarically active solute. So it is in kgs, it is represented by kgs. And osmolarity, riti, means the osmolar concentration expressed as osmole per liter of solution rather than osmoles per kilogram of water. So here it is represented by L. And osmosis, you know, it is a net diffusion of water across the selectively permeable membrane from the region of high water concentration to the one has a lower water concentration. So osmosis is nothing but the movement of water from the high water concentration to the low water concentration. And you can see some of the substances or ions which are present extracellularly and intracellularly here. So here if we check out this diagram, we can easily understand that the watery channels, that is the water allowing channels, are mainly only undergoing diffusion, simple diffusion, channel proteins. But the carriers, you can see carriers are like having facilitated diffusion, and also they're having the active transport. So remember that the channels are involved only in diffusion, but the carriers, understand the difference between channel and carriers. Channels are for the water and the carriers are for facilitated diffusion and also are present in a active transport. So that's we need to, you know, understand. And one more important point is that the greater the motion, the higher is the temperature, and the motion never ceases except at absolute zero temperature. So in diffusion, we can say that diffusion stops at the absolute zero temperature. And we also have one important point, like ions diffuse in the same manner as whole molecules, and even suspended colloid molecules diffuse in similar manner, except that the colloids diffuse far less rapidly than do molecular substances because of the large size. And for the transport of water, we have namely aquaporins, and these aquaporins are 13 different types. This is also one item. For example, you can see the total amount of water that diffuses in each direction through the red blood cell membrane during each second is about 100 times as great as the volume of the red blood cell itself. And here we found one more important, like potassium channels are found to have a tetrameric structure which is consisting of 4 identical protein subunits, and it is surrounded by a central pore. You can see this is about a potassium ion channel, which is having a special structure. Identification protein subunits are surrounding the central pore, and the top of the channel pore loops are forming a narrow selectivity filter, and lining the selectivity filter are the carbonyl oxygens. So when hydrated potassium ions enter the selectivity filter, they interact with the carbonyl oxygens and shed most of their bound water molecules and permit the dehydrated potassium ions to pass through the channel. So the carbonyl oxygens are too far apart, however, to enable them to interact closely with the smaller sodium ions, which are therefore effectively excluded by selectivity filter from passing through the pore. And here is about glue transporters. Actually, glucose have 14 members of a family of membrane proteins, which are mainly called as glute. And this the transport, the glucose transport molecules, and have been discovered in various tissues. So some of this glute can also be transport other monosaccharides that have structures similar to that of glucose, including galactose, fructose. So one of those glucose transporter 4, glute 4, is activated by insulin, and which can increase the rate of facilitated diffusion of glucose like as much as 10 to 20 fold in insulin sensitive tissues. One more important point is like net diffusion rate is proportional to concentration difference across the membrane, as we already seen. And once it's better to look at these formulas, like net diffusion is directly proportional to C0 minus C1. C0 is the concentration outside and CI is the concentration inside. and here also one more formula, EMF in millivolts, C1 by C2. So osmotic pressure is nothing but the amount of pressure which is required to stop the osmosis is called osmotic pressure, and of the sodium chloride solution, here according to exam. And here one more formula is K is equal to mv square by 2.